Pick up the question first. Any question? Anyone? Those who are new in this batch of the learning, mainly Kikul, Prashant, Nagalakshmi, Dr. Dubey, Ashish. Others are repeating. I know this is a kind of revision for them. But I'm very much specific about, Prashant.
Sir, the direct sunlight concept, can it be applied in the morning when the sun is orange in color and during the sunset, as it is not painful and we cannot indulge for a long time.
So. So if you are mindful about your bodily response to the light, then you can do it anytime. But the purpose of doing, if you are thinking that the purpose is some kind of enhancement of the sight by looking at the light and all, these are assumptions according to Pure Nature Cure. The sun, if you are that sun gazing, what we recommend in Pure Nature Cure is sun gazing by closing the eyes. Because the particles will enter through the skin. We need the particle. We do not need the heat. So sun radiation do have these two properties. One is the heat, other is the particle.
So I'm asking when there is no heat, only
There
light.
is no heat. You can definitely look at the sun if it is not irritating. But the purpose of having the particle will be met even if you are looking at the sun by closing your eyes.
Okay. Thank you,
Right?
sir.
There is no beauty in the sun while seeing it. Right? Like definitely a rising sun is a beautiful sight that can be enjoyed undoubtedly. But I'm saying that with the purpose of getting the particle of the sun, solar radiation, that can be met by closing your eyes also.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Ashish, Nagalakshmi, Kekul?
So Kalyan sir, we were talking about following something which gives you pleasure naturally and then avoiding something which is creating that negativity
Idea,
to
idea based stimulation.
So there are a lot of times when we like something which gives us pleasure. It can be a natural, like the most natural thing, but can it become overindulgence at times, and then it starts working adversely? Because like I was discussing with you probably yesterday also when we had this conversation, that you like certain things naturally and you dislike certain things naturally. So I don't know if I've understood it correctly. When it comes to all our senses, the taste that you do not like, you don't indulge, and then in that way you conserve the vitality, because you are avoiding something that is not giving you comfort. So similarly, there will be some things which you may be really fond of. So can you really overindulge and go in the negative direction instead of helping your body or your system overall?
It is assured by the body that there will not be any overindulgence unless you have some idea that mango will actually benefit me specially. This idea may lead you to that indulgence. But if you are mindful about just bodily response out of the mango, then there will not be any possibility of indulgence. So you need to be very mindful about the bodily response to that matter which is entering.
And similarly, I had a question regarding not indulging in something that, even though you are enjoying something, like what I've understood is that if you know why you do not want to get involved in this and you do not pursue it, then probably it's not losing your vitality. You're going to conserve your vitality by not doing it. Like suppose eating something which you know that it is not good for you, and that is the reason why you're not eating. So in a way you are restricting yourself, but here the idea, you are convinced by the idea that yes, it is bad for me and that is the reason why I'm not doing it. Nobody's forcing you, but you have agreed upon within yourself. So is it still going to be on a negative, is it still going to give you that negative impact? Or because you are in terms with it, you it's a fine, it's fine. Yeah.
This is very critical question and a very needful question actually, that you have attraction towards some food and mm-hmm. you have some understanding about that food, that it is going to over-engage my vitality. Let's not term good or bad. Over-engagement of the vitality happens if I consume this. So in this understanding, the basis of this understanding should be the origin analysis. That what is the origin of this food? What is the idea which is working behind manufacturing this food? Mm. If we go into that analytical approach, we will find the idea behind it. That means I am eating not the matter, but the idea of someone.
Okay. No, I'm. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So this aspect of the borrowed idea will deepen my understanding, and the more my understanding go deep, the repulsion towards that food will happen organically. Till that repulsion happen, we may go for that consumption and keep on observing this interaction. Right, so we are not proposing that suppress it right. at once. It is not the proposal, but keep observing. That is the beauty of this whole analysis. If you keep observing, then slowly and gradually we'll feel that repulsion, the lack of attraction towards it.
Okay, so this is what I have observed personally, and that's the reason why, you know, when going through all of this, I was trying to question it, whether it is the right thing to do or not, because I started with the why, that why I should not be eating it. And I am convinced with the why. So I'm not regretting not eating it. But, you know, if that why was not present, I would definitely indulge in it. So in a way, I am suppressing it. But mentally, I'm not regretting that suppression. So it is a positive thing, right?
Yes. It's a conserving thing. Okay. So we'll actually reopen this tomorrow again, probing into the habit modification, because this is a very critical aspect. Yeah, Dr. Dubey.
Same idea I was having, that nightshade plant is going to harm me if I take it. Although I love it, I watch it, it attracts me, but I am not having it for last many months, that it is going to harm me, it will give pain to me. As I have seen or read many literatures in ankylosing spondylitis patient, these nightshade plant usually causes inflammation. But for last few weeks, I am having it and I am having no pain. So what was the idea? Was I met some people, I was having in contact with some people, they are not using, they are getting pain with this tomatoes and all. So out of fear, I was not taking all that food. For last few weeks, I console myself, just have it and see the response. What is happening with you? For last few weeks, I am taking it and I am having no pain with that food.
Yeah, so just you need to be mindful about taking it, that you must enjoy the taste, the matter. No idea that I have to take it or I should not take it. These are ideas. What is real is that taste at the tongue level. If you are enjoying it, continue having it. The moment you stop enjoying it, stop it. Yeah, that will direct us to conserve vitality, because the objective is the single, conserving vitality. Yeah, should we proceed with the next topic? Any other question, Ashish or Nagalakshmi? Are you there, guys?
Yeah,
yes.
No question.
Okay. Nagalakshmi, your
single
voice is...
What the doctor answered now.
Okay.
Same thing I had in mind. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello.
Yeah. Now you're audible. I could hear your proposal. Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you. The same thing what doctor told us now. Like some matter that is good for me. For example, this is taking an example of palak.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's good, but I don't like the taste.
No.
So
why you?
I should be having.
Why it. You think that it is good? Because of some idea,
no,
borrowed idea,
example.
Right?
Yeah, right.
Right.
I just give an example of anything, any fruit or any vegetable. That's obviously any fruit, vegetable in a raw matter is good. So, but
no, it is good, ma'am. It is good only if it tastes good.
Huh. So how will it
good means conserving. Yeah.
Out of 10 good vegetables, if a person doesn't like 8 of them, so is there a way that he has to develop a taste for it?
Yes. So commonly, some food are tasty for Homo sapiens. Commonly. But if I see an exception that I don't like it, all the natural, so how to find out which is natural food for Homo sapiens? Just give it to a baby, the unconditioned baby. If she accepts it, then it is a natural food of Homo sapiens. So if I am not liking it, I am supposed to like it, but I am not liking it, that means some desensitization happened to my tongue because of the conditioned food, idea-based food. So I need to actually go slow and keep observing the change and resensitize my taste. That we need to identify.
Yeah, so until you go through that period, it's a forceful consumption of that nutrition.
So we'll have some of the varieties which are still likable. So we can increase that. That will resensitize our taste sensation. Suppose I'm not liking out of 10 fruits kept in front of me, I'm not liking 6 fruits. Definitely 4 fruits will be there which will be likable. So let's increase that quantity of 4 fruits. That will gradually resensitize my taste skin, taste sensation, and I'll start liking the other fruits as well. I've seen many people who have started liking the fruits that they were not liking before. That's the resensitization. So fruits are very much evident, but these vegetables and all are very assumptions, you know, that palak is good for me or for us and all those things, the green aspects, the green juice enforcement is a lot of cases. It actually proposes a lot of assumptions that I'm not liking it, but I have to put lemon into it to consume it, or some kind of enforcement has to be there. So in small quantity, these are fine, tasteable, likable. Right. Are you able to understand this? The taste aspect of
the
food? Right. So the next topic is the law of unity. The law of unity is the next step of the voice of the organism. The starting point is the voice of the organism, which supports our physical growth primarily. At the moment we are satiated with the physical growth, the moment we don't have any physical vivid problem, we actually are structured to focus on the cognitive growth. If we are confined to focus on the body, physical aspect, then the cognition, we don't bother. Who would like to grow cognitively if my physical aspect is bothering me, right? So after we attain that physical stability, physical homeostasis, the cognitive growth will be programmed to flourish. And that is what is the law of unity. The patterned aspect and connection, the identification of the connectedness, that I have attained a pattern in my conservation and now I'm identifying the connectedness with the realm, with the environment. So when I start connecting with people, connecting with the around entities, that is a confirmation that I have attained conservation at the physical level. It's a confirmation of the conservation. And it leads me to the ultimate growth, because the more we connect around, more I grow cognitively. And ultimately, it creates a symmetry in the universe. Symmetry of me and the universe. So the law of unity is that sense of connectedness, where the symptoms are not identified as the biggest thing, right? So we go at the physical level. If we understand the law of unity, that the body parts all are connected with each other. If I have a knee problem, it is not alone in the knee. It is connected with the blood to my hand also, to my other parts of the body. So the blood which feeds one cell of the body feeds all the cells of the body. So if I have a problem in the blood and it is just coming up through the knees, it doesn't mean that I have a problem in the knee itself, knee only. So it is a throughout the body. If I probe into the cause, then automatically as a byproduct, the system goes, symptom goes away. Right. So,
so I did not understand one thing. How does the, like, what is the rationale behind saying this, that the law of, the understanding of the law of unity leads to symmetry, this sentence?
Understanding of the law of unity leads to law of unity, and not only the understanding, but confirming. So leads to symmetry means when we attained a conservation. Conservation, let me give you an example. Suppose I am, I give this example, the coconut. Coconut, you know, the coconut from that, with the shell, coconut, when it comes to you, from that to taking out the meat of the coconut. It's a process. So I have observed myself, when I started doing it myself, I used to take half an hour to deshell the coconut and take the meat out completely. Now it's a matter of 5 minutes. I can deshell the coconut and take out the meat of it. So how it is achieved? Because through the practice and repeated practice, I attained a pattern. So this is a process of conservation of vitality. When we attain a pattern, now if you observe, if I observe myself doing this work, I see a pattern, proper pattern. I take the coconut, I break it in a pattern. I after that, I take out the, with the knife, I take out the the meat and all. This has got a pattern in itself. I follow that pattern and I need not to strain a lot doing this anymore. So now I am actually trying to share that this can be done this way. To my partner, I'm just showing that this is the way. If she's interested, then this is the way. If she, you can do it, you can attain a pattern. So this sharing actually giving me a pleasure of being connected and sharing of this pattern with others. Are you able to follow? So the conservation is supported by
the other way around. Like, sorry, I think there's some overlapping. My side is slow.
Go ahead, please.
So isn't it the other way around? Like, probably you, or I misheard it, maybe, that the law of unity leads to symmetry. Instead of that, the symmetry leads to the law of unity. That
no, you so, are so that's why I gave right this. Now? That's what I gave the example.
Attaining of the pattern is the attainment of the symmetry, which leads to conservation.
Yeah.
Am I audible, sir?
You are audible, but there was breakage. But let me give you an example. I could understand your question. You are saying that which is first, the voice of the organism or the law of unity? That's the question, right? So the first is voice of the organism because it is internally driven. It is internally driven, then the connection happens. If I start connecting before internal management, internal attainment of the pattern is the first. When we attain that pattern, then that pattern actually flourishes to the external world. If it is other way, then it may have a lot of suppression within. unless I manage this particular entity, which is claimed to be I cannot connect effortlessly. Are you able to understand this? If
Absolute.
I have a lot of struggle inside managing my entity, this self, I'll not be able to comfortably connect with others. So connection with others comes later after managing this pattern of conservation. Right. So at the physical and physiological level, I gave that example of symptoms and the causal correction. If I correct the cause, the symptoms automatically reduces, it goes off. But if I suppress the symptoms, then the cause remains there and symptoms changes its own form and comes back again and again. Right. So this law of unity primarily actually happens through the mental transportation experienced after we attain the individual physical growth, satiation happens. Then we start exploring our cognitive transportation, cognitive growth through the mirroring. The mirroring happens two ways. So these are a little bit of the touching of the aspects, but these are very interesting. Reverse mirroring and forward mirroring. Reverse mirroring is generally seen in children at their growing phase. They start copying others. When they are not matured enough, then they start copying others. And this is a process how they attain their neural potentiality. The neural formation is supported through this reverse mirroring process, because they are still to find themselves. When that an individual finds himself, identifies, this is I, when that has been attained, then the forward mirroring starts. Forward mirroring is seeing oneself in others. I see myself in you. That is what is the forward mirroring. And I see you in me is the reverse mirroring. Right? These are the process of mental transportation that we do by default. Just the terms are being shared here. So we can identify and correlate this thing with our lives. So forward mirroring, I shared that it can be a static mirroring. It can be a dynamic mirroring. When I am transporting myself to a static entity, to a book, which is not a dynamic, which is not changing, then it is a static mirroring. I'm learning a skill, static mirroring. But I am trying to understand you. I cannot claim that tomorrow I'll be able to understand the way I have understood today, because you are dynamic, you are changing. Tomorrow you are going to change. I have to actually again do the mirroring dynamically to understand and keep on understanding you. And that gives you a tremendous sense of growth for the individual when we dynamically mirror with others. And this is naturally, it occurs. It is nothing that we have to learn it and we have to do it. We have to unblock the over-engagement of vitality. This will occur automatically. Yeah, we talked about that confused cognitive growth, and I left there that the spirituality and fragility. So the confused cognitive growth, actually Minu already started that discussion, that if we proceed to the self-conservation reverse way, if I start connecting with others, but I'm not managing the physical pattern, I have not attained my own conservation, and I'm just... Yeah, Nagalakshmi, you have some question? Ma'am?
No, I don't have some.
Okay, you're unmute. That's why I thought. So that's a kind of confused cognitive growth where we start actually focusing law of unity more than the voice of the organism. Voice of the organism is knowing myself. Law of unity is expanding myself. So unless I know myself, if I probe into expanding myself, then it is a confused cognitive growth, and that leads to fragility and compromised longevity also. We have seen a lot of spiritual leaders, they are cognitively evolved, but physically compromised. That's what is the fragility. So symmetry is actually a natural beauty. We need not to do a lot. We just need to unblock ourselves to attain the symmetry. We need not to bring a lot of ideas of bringing symmetry and the law of unity in the lives. It's actually, there are a lot of symmetry examples given in this document, which you can see through, that radial symmetry is there. These are just examples. These are not very important concepts. Bilateral symmetry, spherical symmetry. These are there in the notes that are shared. Spiral symmetry is something exceptional. Now, symmetry in the skills, I've shared. Symmetry in the skill, that coconut example is the symmetry in the skill that we attain. That we attained a pattern, and that pattern is a symmetry. When somebody does a skill, execute a skill effectively, you'll find a symmetry in that pattern. If somebody is doing something and you see that that person is very confused, very tired, very haphazard, then it is not a symmetry. You don't enjoy it, right? When you see somebody doing the way it is being done as if it is being done effortlessly, then only we term that it is an excellent performance. Try to correlate the understanding and these terms. So whenever there is a symmetry in the skill,
on we seeing something of somebody else and not the person himself.
Both. If I'm doing something comfortably, like for instance, in the afternoon session, the start of the afternoon session, I found myself very much jeopardized with that breakage of the connection. I was not able to concentrate on this because I had to manage the router to be rebooted and all those things. So that was not giving me a comfort or the pattern. Now I'm talking effortlessly because I'm not to worry about that. That thing got settled. Now it's a pattern that I have achieved and the class is flowing effortlessly. Right. That's what I mean. So when you observe someone to execute a skill or you execute yourself a skill, unless there is a symmetry attained, it is not effortless. That symmetry will indicate that you have attained an effortlessness, and effortlessness means conservation of vitality.
So when do you also mean to say that if someone is doing something effortlessly, the other people will definitely sense it, or it's not necessary?
It's not necessary. It is irrelevant. Whether other people is sensing it or not, that's an irrelevant thing. But definitely, as a byproduct, it happens that an excellent performance is an effortless performance.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, symmetry in being is termed as the integrity. Integrity will take up this. Integrity means there is a congruence in these three layers: action, feeling, and thinking. Other words, action, words actually depicts our feelings and the thought. If there is a congruence, if we are doing the things whatever I am thinking and I am feeling also the same way, if there is a congruence, then there is an integrity, and there that conforms to the symmetry in the being. Now it starts here. If we defy the voice of the organism and the law of unity, we suffer a state called innervation, because we are compromising the conservation of vitality, and innervation is just reverse of the conservation of vitality. It is a state of over-engaged vitality beyond the limit when toxin or the waste elimination is reduced. Because I have a limited vitality, limited quotient of vitality, this is over-engaged here and there. You can identify that the examples that has been shared are absolutely relatable. I have this in my life. You must be thinking that way. That yes, I have food wise, you can identify a lot, and otherwise also. Mobile is one example that we have given. Fragrance, the artificial fragrance is another. So these kind of things are, multiple things are there in our life, which actually lead us to over engagement of vitality. So when we have some limited amount of energy, which is engaged some or other way, so the normal activity is reduced. And the normal activity, the primary normal activity, which is compromised in this case, is the output. Output of the toxin waste, which happens through the sweat, breathing out, and urination. Through our three filtering elements, which are skin for the sweat, which is lung for the breathing, and which is kidney for the urination. These actually filter the blood. The filtration of the blood is compromised, and which hardly be noticed by the individual at the beginning. And which leads the individual to a state called toxemia, because the toxins are not thrown out of the blood. So this is a state of toxemia, where due to innervation, when the body reduces elimination, it retains and accumulates toxin. A state of accumulated toxin in the body is called toxemia. Right? Now, we started in the morning session, we ended that particular morning session, if you remember, with three holistic properties: density, speed, and heat. So a note to think that the toxin, if it is there in the blood as an extra material, extra matter, that will increase the density. So a non-toxic blood will be less denser than the toxic blood. Try and understand this aspect. A non-toxic blood will be less denser than the toxic blood. And the speed will be reversed. A toxic person will have slow speed comparing to the non-toxic blood person, non-toxic person. So the movement will be affected. So we'll probe into these three properties tomorrow for the implementation purpose, how we can improve upon our conservation of vitality by probing into these three properties: density, speed, and the heat. The heat is also sensed less in the toxic person. Non-toxic person will have more heat in the body. Will be very vital person, we call. That means a lot of energy is there inside. Heat is a form of energy, right? So that ends this session. Tomorrow we'll be actually touching upon the vitality ribbon also, which was left. So which is a very short topic. We'll cover it up. So that's it from my side. Any question that you'd like to? A lot of information, I understand. A lot of information has gone into it, but keep observing and bring your question. Yeah. Ashish?
Maybe I'll have some questions for tomorrow.
Okay, sir. So think through whatever the proposals are there. And tomorrow morning, we'll start with the myths concept. And then we'll have this vitality ribbon also. Myths is very interesting. All those three aspects, the infection, immunity, and deficiency, we'll touch upon. Yeah, Kekul, Nagalakshmi, Prashant, Shankar.
It's been a lot of information very quickly. So we'll need some time to sit over it, reflect, and then probably tomorrow, if there's anything that I need to clear, we'll do that.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Nagalakshmi, are you comfortable? Yes, ma'am. Okay, this Prashant. Prashant, are you there?
Yeah.
It's comfortable, sir, so far?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Shankar and Soparna. Soparna said that his audio is not working. Shankar?
Yeah, I'm okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you. So let's meet at 9 a.m. tomorrow. Right?
Thank you.
Okay. Right. Okay. Thank you.